Good morning. Thank you for coming to Sunday School this morning. I read something a couple days ago. The guy said he was all excited. His loan came through. He was headed for the gas station. It's going up. I've never seen it go up right in front of your eyes almost. All right. This morning, we're going to continue with the poetic books or poetry, but I actually, in a more technical sense, it's perhaps better to call it wisdom literature, because not all these five are, as we would think of, poetry, but what they are is brutally honest about the human condition. We sometimes forget that these people in the Bible were just like us. They're real people. They have mood swings. They get depressed. They get discouraged. They get blessed. They have fears. They have big questions, tough questions. I mean, you know, Job wrestles with the suffering of the righteous. Why do righteous people suffer? Song of Solomon deals with romantic love. Ecclesiastes looks at life and considers it all vain, vanity, vanity. So wisdom literature it taps into the human condition, the human experience. Now, some of it is poetry, but as we mentioned before, it's not like English poetry, which, not exclusively, and I'm not into poetry, so I'm not going to pretend I am. But when I think of poetry, I think of a rhyme. You know, I realize that not all English poetry is a rhyme. I do remember way back somewhere learning about iambic pentameter. I don't have any idea what that means anymore, but I think Shakespeare is an example of that, where there's a cadence and you got a line and then another line or whatever. But Hebrew poetry it lacks rhyme. It lacks a regular meter. What's really big on is parallelism, where one line, especially Proverbs is a good example, but you'll have one line and then a line that either is synonymous or contradictory, and it's thinking about the two lines that is the benefit of the Proverbs. But this morning we are going to look specifically, or continue to look specifically at the book of Psalms. So if you want to turn to Psalm 13. Psalm 13. Again, the benefit of, as I said, the book of Psalms is that it has a large range of emotion. In fact, we're going to see here there are different kinds of psalms. They're not all the same. They fall into different categories. Now, you may see another list that deletes one of these categories and adds another category, and they're not always as clean. You know, we like systematic theology likes everything in a system that, you know, there's these five things. Some of the Psalms are a mixture of these things. Some are hard to fit into an exact category, but we are going to look at these. So what we're going to do this morning is we're going to look at these different categories and then look at some examples of psalms that tell us or that demonstrate what we mean by this. Let's pray. Yes, Lord, the psalms are a wide variety of types, genres. Some make us... Some of them at times shock us that the psalmist would say that and that it'd be recorded in Scripture. But Lord, they're honest. They're brutally sometimes honest. But they're also comforting. Most of the time, they do end up with a recognition that we have to trust God when there are things that we don't understand or seem to be contrary to what we would think life should bring. So Lord, open our eyes, and maybe more importantly here, open our hearts to identify with these different emotions that we experience as a people made in your image, in the image of God. Amen. All right, if you look at Psalm 12, did I say 13? I think I meant 12. Psalm 12. Help, Lord, for the godly man ceases to be, for the faithful disappear from among the sons of men. They speak falsehood to one another. With flattering lips and with a double heart they speak. May the Lord cut off all flattering lips, the tongue that speaks great things, who have said, with our tongue we will prevail, our lips are our own. Who is Lord over us? Because of the devastation of the afflicted, because of the groaning of the needy, now I will arise, says the Lord. I will set him in the safety for which he longs. The words of the Lord are pure words, as a silver tried in a furnace of earth, refined seven times. You, O Lord, shall keep them. You shall preserve him from this generation forever. The wicked strut about on every side when vileness is exalted among the sons of men. Okay. Here we have an example of what's called a song of lament. A song of lament. To lament, of course, is to cry, basically. Shorthand version of it is to cry over one's condition. It's a complaint. The Psalms of lament are psalms of complaint. The psalmist is complaining about something. He's complaining that in this example that as he looks at the people around him, that there's hardly any godly people left. There's hardly any faithful people left. The people that are around him speak with flattering lips and double hearts. They make big boasts. They think that by their claims, they will prevail, and that no one has the authority to tell them that they're not speaking truth. And because of this, the afflicted suffer, the needy groan. But I will arise, says the Lord, and I will set him in safety for which he belongs, the righteous man. So, you'll see here where there's a complaint, a description, but at the end, I will trust in God. The Lord will eventually arise. He will eventually preserve the righteous, verse 7. So those are songs of what we call lament. There are at least six of those psalms that fall into that category. Go to Psalm 6. O Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger, nor chasten me in your wrath. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am pining away. Heal me, O Lord, for my bones are dismayed, and my soul is greatly dismayed. But you, O Lord, how long? Return, O Lord, rescue my soul. Save me because of your loving kindness, there's no mention of you in death and Sheol, who will give you thanks? In other words, don't let me die, Lord. That wouldn't get you any praise from that. I am weary with my sighing. Every night I make my bed swim. I dissolve my couch with my tears. My eye has wasted away with grief. It's because it has become old because of all my adversaries. Depart from me, all you who do iniquity, for the Lord has heard the voice of my weeping. The Lord has heard my supplication. The Lord receives my prayer. All my enemies will be ashamed and greatly dismayed. They shall turn back. They will suddenly be ashamed. Now, this is a penitent psalm, an example of doing penance, if you will. This is a psalm that expresses sorrow, a broken heart, particularly because of a person's sin, but here it seems to be because of illness. But it expresses the emotion that they're having, but also asks for grace. So we're not alone when we are suffering. When we're crying, he makes his bed swim. He cries so much. His couch is dissolved with his tears. His eyes are wasting away because of all the crying. That's a normal human condition. It's not somehow ungodly to cry. It's not ungodly to talk to the Lord and say, I don't understand this. You go back to verse 1, and you'll notice that, Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger, nor hasten me in your wrath, but be gracious to me, O Lord. So again, he wants to, make sure that that the cause of his suffering isn't because of his sin, but if it is, then he confesses that. So that's a penitent psalm. There are lots of those in the book of Psalms. When you're feeling down, discouraged, depressed, the Psalms are a good place to turn because they are honest with with the human condition. Psalm 10. Psalm 10, why do you stand afar off, O Lord? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble? In pride the wicked hotly pursue the afflicted. Let them be caught up in the plots which they have devised. For the wicked boasts of his heart's desire, and the greedy man curses and spurns the Lord. The wicked in his haughtiness and of his countenance does not seek him. All his thoughts are, there is no God. His ways prosper at times. Your judgments are on high, out of his sight. As for all of his adversaries, he snorts at them. He says to himself, I will not be moved. Throughout all generations, I will not be in adversity. His mouth is full of curses and deceit and oppression. Under his tongue is mischief and wickedness. He sits in the lurking places of the villages. In the hiding places, he kills the innocent. His eyes stealthily watch for the unfortunate. He lurks in the hiding place as a lion in his lair. He lurks to catch the afflicted. He catches the afflicted when he draws him to his net. He crouches, he bows down, and the unfortunate fall by his mighty ones. He says to himself, God has forgotten. He has hidden his face. He will never see it. Arise, O Lord, lift up your hand, and do not forget the afflicted. Why has the wicked spurned God? He said to himself, you will not require it. He don't think God will judge him for it. You have seen it, for you have beheld mischief and vexation to take into your hand. The unfortunate commits himself to you. You have been the helper of the orphan. Break the arm of the wicked and the evildoer. Set the wickedness until you find none. The Lord is king forever and ever. Nations have perished from his land. O Lord, you have heard the desire of the humble. You will strengthen their heart. you incline your ear to vindicate the orphan and the oppressed, so the man who is of the earth will no longer cause terror. This is an imprecatory psalm. Again, there's more of those in the book than you would suspect. It's a prayer, it's a psalm, it's a cry for judgment. God, why don't you judge these people? Look at their what they're doing. Look at the ungodly choices they're making. Here they seem to be prospering. They don't think you're going to do anything about it. They don't think you're paying attention. Particularly, the imprecatory psalms deal with a prayer about your enemies, asking God to judge your enemies. But they always end up with a trust in God. What will God, God, you will do what you're going to do. But sometimes they're pretty tough to swallow. The psalmist prays some harsh things, but that's the way sometimes we feel. Psalm 8. Now, this Psalm 8 is an example of the majority of the Psalms. When we think of the Psalms, we don't always think about our calls for vengeance. We don't often think of the fact that we are brokenhearted or that we need to confess. Most of the Psalms fall into the category 8, which is a praise psalm. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have displayed your splendor above the heavens. From the mouth of infants and nursing babes, you have established strength because of your adversaries to make the enemy and the revengeful cease. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have ordained, what is man that you take thought of him? The son of man that you care for him, yet you have made him a little lower than God, and you crown him with glory and majesty. You make him to rule over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen and all the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes through the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. So most of the Psalms, the vast majority of the Psalms, fall into this category, the praise Psalms, which are hymns, basically, praising God for who he is and what he's done. All right, go to Psalm 18. Another example are royal psalms, which focus on Israel's king. Look at Psalm 18, verse 50. Psalm 18, 50. He gives great deliverance to his king. And shows love and kindness to his anointed, to David, and to his descendants forever. So here was a psalm particularly directed at King David, God's anointed, who God is going to give deliverance to. go to Psalm 100. Psalm 100, shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful singing. Know that the Lord himself is God. It is he who has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his loving kindness is everlasting, and his faithfulness to all generations. This, of course, is a Thanksgiving psalm. And there are about 30 of those in the book of Psalms. And they give thanks to God, but usually for something specific, some help that God has provided. And these are really the Psalms that we think more of gratitude. All right, Psalm 49. Psalm 49, hear this, O peoples, all peoples. Give ear, all inhabitants of the world, both low and high, rich and poor, together. My mouth will speak wisdom, and the meditation of my heart will be understanding. I will incline my ear to a proverb. I will express my riddle with a harp. Why should I fear in days of adversity when the iniquity of my foes surround me? But those who trust in their wealth and boast in the abundance of their riches, no man can by any means redeem his brother or give to God a ransom for him. For the redemption of his soul is costly, and he should cease trying forever, that he should live on eternally, that he should not undergo decay. For he sees that even wise men die, the stupid and the senseless alike perish and leave their wealth to others. Their inner thought is that their houses are forever and their dwelling places to all generations. They have called their lands after their own names, but man in his pomp will not endure. He is like the beasts that perish. This is the way of those who are foolish and of those who approve their words, Selah. As sheep they are appointed to Sheol, to death. Death shall be their shepherd. And the upright shall rule over them in the morning, and their form shall be for Sheol to consume, so that they have no habitation. They're going to rot in the grave. But God will redeem my soul from the power of Sheol, for he receives me. Do not be afraid when a man becomes rich, when the glory of his house is increased. For when he dies, he will carry nothing away. His glory will not descend after him. Though while he lives, he congratulates himself. And though men praise you when you do well for yourself, you shall go to the generations of his father. They will never see the light. Man in his pomp, yet without understanding, is like the beasts that perish. This is a wisdom psalm. Wisdom psalms are observations on the way God intended life to be. This psalm, obviously, is talking about the foolishness of riches, about people who think that somehow their riches are going to last forever, and that because they're rich, they don't have to think about death and dying. So these psalms are what are called wisdom psalms. In fact, you can see even in verse 4, he likens it to a proverbs. Here he's given a proverb about riches. Go to Psalm 110. Psalm 110 is the most quoted psalm in the New Testament. You find it all over the New Testament, portions of it. It is a messianic psalm. It talks about God's coming Messiah or coming anointed one. Again, Psalm 110 is the most famous because it's the most quoted in the New Testament. You'll notice it says, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." So the Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand. So it takes the New Testament to explain exactly what does that mean. The Lord will stretch forth your strong scepter from Zion, saying, rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will volunteer freely in the days of your power, in holy array from the womb of the dawn. Your youth are to you as dew. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings in the day of his wrath. He will judge among the nations, and he will fill them with corpses. He will scatter the chief men over the broad country, and he will drink by the brook, by the wayside. Therefore, he will lift up his head. The Lord, it's a reference to, of course, God the Father and God the Son. So you go back to verse 1. The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand. So God the Father is speaking to God the Son. All right, go to the book of Proverbs. So I would encourage you to read through the book of Psalms. Read one a day or whatever fits your schedule, but try to think of what category, what genre you think that psalm would fit in. But more importantly, what emotion, do you identify with in that psalm, and take solace in the fact that you're not the only one that's ever felt that way. Okay, as I have shared in the past, one of the best things I ever did in my life was, humanly speaking, just circumstance, but I realize it really wasn't, but... When I was in Bible college, I came into the classroom, and I was a freshman, and that whatever class was in the room before us, I don't even know who was the professor, but on the board it said, read a proverb a day. And I hadn't really read the Proverbs too much, so I thought, well, I think I'll try that. And probably for the next 25 years, I read a Proverbs a day. You can read through it in a month. So I would read it through it, about 12 times a month, a year. But I truly believe that that played the biggest part in my Christian growth as a young person, as a young man, the book of Proverbs. Now, you got to remember, back then I was at a King James only college, so the book of Proverbs from the King James is quite a treat. There's a lot of things you gotta decipher. So I did, and I'm glad for it. But perhaps you might want to try the Proverbs in a different translation. But again, they speak so much to young men, particularly. I mean, look at Proverbs chapter 1. We won't read. read the whole chapter, but verse 1, the Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, to know wisdom and instruction, to discern the sayings of understanding, to receive instruction and wise behavior, righteousness, justice, and equity, to give prudence to the naive. There's a big line right there. To give prudence to the naive, to the youth, knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear and increase in learning, and a man of understanding will acquire wise counsel. To understand a proverb and a figure, the words of the wise and their riddles. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. There's the key verse, of course, of Proverbs. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. But look at verse 8. Hear, my son, your father's instruction, and do not forsake your mother's teaching. So, again, I'm not saying that Proverbs is only written to young people or only to young men. I am saying that the book of Proverbs did have in mind young men particularly, okay? These were instructions of a father to his son. Now, they obviously have universal application. We can all get knowledge from Proverbs. It's a great book. I love the book of Proverbs. But clearly we see here that it was a father's advice to a son on wise living, practical guidance for wise living. Solomon was the primary author. In fact, he may have been the only author in chapter 30. Some of the Proverbs are anonymous, but seem to have been from Solomon. Chapter 30 says this one is from Agar, and 31 from Lemuel. But it's very possible that was just a pen name for Solomon. There is evidence that during the days of Hezekiah that the Proverbs were compiled. In fact, we know that Solomon gave many more Proverbs than what we have, many more. But Ezekiel compiled what we have as the book of Proverbs. So it stretches, if you will, from Solomon to Ezekiel. I'm going to try to get through these last two so we can... Ecclesiastes. Again, Solomon, the preacher. Here he approaches life from a preacher's standpoint. Verse 1, Ecclesiastes 1:1. The words of the preacher, the son of David, king in Jerusalem. Vanity of vanities, says the preacher. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. I go to chapter 12. So through this sermon, which has a lot of vanity in it, okay, the theme, as you see there, is the emptiness of life apart from God. The emptiness of life apart from God. Now, Proverbs were probably written all throughout Solomon's reign, okay. Ecclesiastes seems to be written during Solomon's final days, his old age, which had been around 935 BC. But you notice he comes to a conclusion, chapter 12, verse 13. The conclusion, okay, when all this has been heard is, now remember, Solomon had everything, riches, women, power, reputation, and as he goes through each of those things in this book, he says it's all vanity. The conclusion when all has been heard is fear God and keep his commandments, because this applies to every person. For God will bring every act of judgment, everything which is hidden, whether it is good or bad. All right, turn to the Song of Solomon. Solomon chapter 1, verse 1. The Song of Songs, which is Solomon's. May he kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is better than wine. Your oils have a pleasing fragrance. Your name is like purified oil. Therefore the maidens love you. Draw me from you and let us run together. The king has brought us into his chambers. Okay, so the book of Solomon, or the book of Solomon, the Song of Solomon, was probably written during Solomon's early reign, and it's a love story about a bride and the bridegroom. it goes back and forth between the words of the bride and the words of the bridegroom. Okay, I think I was talking to Chris about this week, and he said in college, in their wisdom literature class, what they did is they'd have a girl read the girl's, the bride's part, and then a guy read the bridegroom's part. So it's good for effect, but it's pretty embarrassing to the participants, right? It's a good way to figure out the dialogue, but also, you know, especially if you're young and single. So I don't know if we'll try that someday or not. Key verse, chapter 7. Turn too many pages. Chapter 7. I am not thinking too straight right now. I went from too far to too far back. All right. Solomon, chapter 7, verse 1-10. And again, this is not, I don't think I've ever preached in the book of Solomon, and there's a good reason. How beautiful are your feet in sandals, O prince's daughter. The curve of your hips are like jewels, the work of the hands of an artist. Your navel is like a round goblet, which never lacks mixed wine. Your belly is like a heap of wheat, fits about with lilies. Your breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle. Your neck is like a tower of ivory. Your eyes are like the pools of Heshbon by the gate of Bath-Ribbim. Your nose is like the tower of Lebanon, which faces towards Damascus. Your head crowns you like Carmel. The flowing locks of your head are like purple threads. The king is captivated by your tresses. How beautiful and how delightful you are, my love, with all your charms. Your stature is like a palm tree, and your breasts are like clusters. I said, I will climb the palm tree. I will take hold of its fruit stalks. May your breasts be like clusters of the vine, and the fragrance of your breath like apples. Your mouth like the best wine that goes down smoothly for my beloved, flowing gently through the lips of those who fall asleep. I am my beloved, and his desire is for me. So the Song of Solomon traces the progress of intimacy from initial attraction to maturity. The takeaway is that sex within marriage is God's good gift. Sex within marriage is God's good gift. All right, let's pray. Lord, we thank you that the Bible covers all of life, really. You speak to intimate matters. You speak to matters of the heart. You speak to motives. You speak to us when we're brokenhearted, when we're angry, when we want to take things in our own hands. Lord, when we're young and naive, when we're old and looking back at life, so we thank you that it's all there. And Lord, what we just need to do is read it, apply it, dwell on it, chew on it, think on it. But we thank you for it. Pray in Christ's name.